Welcome to the second webinar hosted by the Philippine Society of Pediatric Surgeons. Our second topic is entitled Stem Cell Therapy and its Application to Common Congenital Pediatric Conditions. This topic was inspired by the late Dr. Leandro Resurrección III. Being a very innovative surgeon, always on the lookout for new studies and treatments to apply to his patients. In this discussion, we have Professor Nguyen Thanh Liem, a famous pediatric laparoscopic surgeon from Hanoi, Vietnam, to talk about the latest discovery on stem cell therapy, its principle and its medical use in the treatment of cerebral palsy. We also have a distinguished speaker, Dr. Carolyn Butler, a pediatric neurologist, to speak about cerebral palsy and its current medical management. On August 27, is the role of social media, telemedicine in healthcare during the so-called new normal, and its possible doctor-patient liabilities. In this time of pandemic, telemedicine, otherwise called as teleconsult, telehealth, or online consultation, have become a common practice among us doctors. For fear of catching the COVID-19 virus, our patients who refuse to go to the hospital have been consulting us through an online platform. But do you know that there could be potential pitfalls and danger in doing this? There are certain liabilities that we must be aware of. Because of this, we have invited well-known speakers to give us a talk on how to use telemedicine and social media during these times, as well as on what should and should not be done in order to avoid mistakes that could compromise either the patients or our practice. And lastly, on September 4, the last webinar concerns a very interesting topic on entrepreneurship 101 among doctors, which veers away from our practice as physicians. As medical practitioners, there will come a time that we will retire from the medical profession, whether we like it or not. So what shall we do then? Isn't it good to still be earning money from different sources other than our profession? To have money on the side while enjoying retirement is something that we all want. We have invited several well-known medical speakers and a financial advisor who will give us few tips on how to start another stream of income and share with us his experience and advice on how to handle our finances and what to do with our hard-earned money to make it grow further. We have carefully selected four different webinar topics to cater to this time of pandemic, to help our fellow medical professionals adapt and thrive in this so-called new normal. We hope you will take part in this series of four interesting webinars. Thank you very much and God bless you all. Good morning.
To introduce the speakers for today, here is Dr. Edric Liem.
Good morning. It is my honor and privilege to introduce the speakers for this morning. Our first speaker is Dr. Carolyn A. Butler. She is a pediatric neurologist, a graduate of UERM College of Medicine, had her pediatric residency at Interfaith Medical Center, Brooklyn, New York, and had the Childhood Neurology Fellowship also at SANI Health Center, Brooklyn, New York. She also had an epilepsy fellowship also at SANI Health Center, Brooklyn, New York. She is a diplomate of both American Academy of Pediatrics and the Philippine Pediatric Society. She is affiliated at Makati Medical Center and Aison Hospital Medical Center. Our second speaker is Professor Nguyen Thanh Liem. He is a pediatric surgeon, graduated at Hanoi Medical University, and also had his PhD at the same institution. He had his residency in surgery and pediatric surgery at Viet Duc Hospital, Hanoi. He is the head department of pediatric surgery, National Hospital of Vietnam. Director, Vietnam National Children's Hospital, and he was the recipient of the 2018 Nikkei Asia Prize in Science, Technology, and Environment. He is also the director of Vinmec Research Institute of Stem Cell and Gene Technology, and is the current president of the Vietnam Society of Pediatric Surgeons. So sit back, relax, enjoy the lectures, and if you have any questions, just post them on the Q&A and also on the chat box. Thank you.
Let us welcome our first speaker, Dr. Carolyn Butler.
Good morning, everyone. I would like to thank the Philippine Society of Pediatric Surgeons for inviting me this morning to talk to you. I have no disclosures. I've been asked to present a short talk on the background of cerebral palsy. I will touch on the definition, risk factors, classification, and then touch on a little bit about the social, economic, and medical burden it places on society. I will then try and relate some of our experience here in the Philippines. And last, I will touch on some treatment options with a focus on medical treatments. Cerebral palsy is a leading cause of childhood disability affecting function and development. It describes a group of permanent disorders of movement and posture and activity limitation that are attributed to non-progressive disturbances that have occurred in the developing fetal or immature brain. It is not a single diagnosis, but an umbrella term describing motor or postural abnormalities that are noted during early development and are due to non-progressive brain lesions. It's accompanied by disturbances of sensation, perception, cognition, communication, and behavior, by epilepsy, and by secondary musculoskeletal problems. The prevalence is believed to be about 1.5 to 6 in 1,000 live births, with variations depending high income to middle and low income and in different geographic regions of the world. Most children are diagnosed within the first 2 years of life. It's a clinical diagnosis based on a combination of clinical, such as a delay in development, and neurological, such as an abnormal movement or posture. It's a lifelong condition, and it can have significant medical and economic impact on the affected individual, their families, and society. 50% will use assistive devices to develop or maintain mobility, and two-thirds have other dissociative disabilities. There are many that would prefer us to look at this more as a spectrum disorder versus a discrete clinical disorder. Why? Because with children in cerebral palsy, no two children are the same. A child with cerebral palsy will have different risk factors and different underlying etiologies than someone else. They will have different neurologic impairments and different clinical features. Each child will vary depending on the severity of their functional limitations and what kind of secondary conditions and comorbidities they have. Each one will have different treatment options. And the evolution of the condition over the lifespan from one individual with CP to the other will be completely different. So, what causes this? We know that the underlying pathophysiology is an injury to the developing brain during the prenatal through the neonatal period, as well as in the postnatal brain. As we know that the brain and the nervous system, myelination, mature all the way up until 5 years old, it is believed that this extends from 0 to 5 years old. Historically, prematurity and low birth weight were felt to be the most important risk factors. However, multiple epidemiologic studies have borne out the fact that half of children who developed CP were born at term and didn't have any identified risk factors. Hence, we no longer say it has a single cause or disease entity that results in CP, but rather risk factors that have been identified with increasing the risk for cerebral palsy or associated with the development of cerebral palsy. So, what are these risk factors? Well, first we look at the antenatal, or insults that can happen to the fetal brain. This would include your congenital brain malformations, genetic susceptibility, in utero strokes or perinatal strokes, in vitro fertilization, maternal disorders of clotting, torch infections, multiple gestation, pre-pregnancy obesity, and let's not forget your teratogenic drugs and alcohol. Risk factors according to the perinatal period would include your children who were born with hypoxic ischemic encephalopathy or suffer perinatal strokes, kernicterus, low birth weight, born premature, maternal fetal infections, have neonatal seizures, or unfortunately have neonatal sepsis or meningitis. Your postnatal risk factors have been attributed to your postnatal CNS infections, postnatal trauma, such as accidents or falls or child abuse, drowning or near drowning, stroke syndromes, and toxins, such as lead or organophosphate poisoning. Cerebral palsy can be classified according to its neurologic impairment, and the most common are your spasticity, then your dyskinesias, your hypotonic kids, and your ataxia. But mixed presentations are very common. In fact, one of the most common presentations is someone who has a truncal hypotonia but with spasticity of the extremity. Most people know it being classified according to the clinical presentation. In other words, what's the tone and which limbs are involved? There's the spastic or pyramidal CP, the dyskinetic or your extrapyramidal CP, and again, a mixed type, your extrapyramidal plus your spastic. Your spastic or your pyramidal cerebral palsy makes up the biggest group of children who have cerebral palsy, about 80%. It's characterized by spasticity, hyperreflexia, clonus, and an upgoing Babinski. And it's due mainly to lesions or insults that happen to the cortex and the pyramidal tract. It can be further broken down into those who have a spastic diplegia, a spastic hemiplegia, and a spastic quadriplegia. Your dyskinetic or your extrapyramidal CP is characterized by abnormal movements, your athenoid, distoid, your choreoathetoid, your chorea, and these are due to lesions in the basal ganglia and the thalamus. Again, your extrapyramidal and your spastic make up a very big percentage. And we need to keep in mind that as the child's developing nervous system matures, the clinical presentation will also change. So I'm going to talk a little bit about the spastic diplegia. This actually makes up usually the biggest category of children with CP, about 35% of cases. In preterms, if the child had a risk factor of prematurity, it is often associated with intraventricular hemorrhage and subsequent periventricular encephalomalacia. In term babies, often no risk factors are found. Initially, they present with a period of hypotonicity and later develop spasticity in all extremities, with the lower extremities more than the upper. They often have developmental delay, in particular in their gross motor skills. They may have eye findings. About 50 to 60% will have visual defects. And although some will have mild cognitive impairment, one out of two will have a normal cognition. Seizures are present in about 25% of these children. Your spastic quadriplegia makes up a smaller amount, but has the most serious problems. It's associated with focal and multifocal ischemic brain lesions, diffuse cortical atrophy, and sometimes hydrocephalus. These are often children that are born at term, often with a history of hypoxic ischemic encephalopathy, perinatal or postnatal infections, and or neurometabolic or neurogenetic disorders. They also start with an initial period of hypotonia, and they develop an extensor spasticity in all their extremities. They have a very high incidence of associated conditions. In particular, there is usually significant cognitive dysfunction, oromotor dysfunction, and pseudobulbar involvement. They often have feeding difficulties, and many will end up with a G-tube or be feeding by OGT, and a good half of them will have seizures. Your dyskinetic or your extrapyramidal CP is another group that's smaller, but much harder to treat in many ways. It comprises the phenotypes of the choreoathetoid, dystonic, or dyskinetic groups. It makes up about 15% of cases of cerebral palsy in the Western or your higher income literature. These children are usually born at term, associated with hypoxic ischemic encephalopathy, kernicterus in particular, neurometabolic and neurogenetic disorders. They also have a high incidence of associated conditions, such as cognitive deficits, seizures, behavioral problems, sleep disturbances, visual and hearing impairments. So, early diagnosis and early intervention is believed to be the key role, okay, in maximizing the optimal plasticity and function of a young brain, so as to optimize better functional outcome. In a child who receives early intervention and early medical care and ongoing support, most will grow up to be adults. 2 out of 3 will be ambulatory with or without assistance. 3 out of 4 will have the ability to speak. And 1 out of 2 will have normal cognitive ability. But it is a lifelong condition. So how early can you diagnose CP? Instead, if you diagnose it early and get early intervention, you might be able to have a better outcome. Well, a professor from the University of Zurich took a look at this. Novak et al. Surmised that since the signs and symptoms of CP emerge and evolve before the age of 2, a combination of standardized tests and clinical history should be able to predict a risk. He then proceeded to do a systematic review, looking at all published literature between 1988 and 2016, to determine the best available evidence for early and accurate diagnosis of cerebral palsy. And what did he find? Indeed, he did find that it was possible to diagnose in early infancy if there was a risk factor. Using a combination of a good clinical history identifying a risk factor, neuroimaging using an MRI, and using individualized standardized assessment neuromotor and motor skill tests, he was able to successfully identify children less than age of 5 months about 90% of the time, and greater than 5 months or 6 months corrected age almost 90% of the time. Well, perhaps in a perfect world with a known risk factor, and perhaps with detailed, meticulous clinical history, no barriers to obtaining MRI scans, and standardized neuromotor assessments, perhaps it is possible to diagnose that earlier. However, we all live in a real world with or without risk factors, and the Philippines is a very real world. In most cases, clinical primary care settings or in pediatric clinics, most diagnoses are made between 1 to 2 years of age and sometimes even later. And it is often brought to the attention but to the doctor by the mother because of a noted delay in the development of motor function or development progression. However, it is always good to try and hope that we can improve it and do an earlier diagnosis. So these children have a number of comorbidities and functional limitations, and we tend to divide it into 3 groups. You have your neurologic comorbidities, which include your intellectual disability, epilepsy, speech and language disorders. You have your musculoskeletal comorbidities due to the increasing spasticity that tends to occur. Eventually, may have hip dysplasia, dislocations, and scoliosis as they go through puberty. Other comorbidities include hearing impairments, visual impairments. A number of them have feeding difficulties and significant nutritional disorders, behavioral disorders, sleep disorders, and chronic pain. Hence, the treatment to this disease is really got to be multimodal and multidisciplinary. It will involve a team of doctors in the perfect world. So what happens here in the Philippines? What do we know? Well, it'd be first nice to know if we had a prevalence, but we don't. There is no known central data registry. The NSO statistics of 2010, which is the last complete one we have, although we're due now, it did list that 16 out of 1,000, or 1.6%, had a disability. And it did list that 18.9% of these were children from 0 to 14 years of age. But we don't know, cerebral palsy was lumped into that disability. We don't know how many had this particular disorder. There is no published epidemiologic study on this population, nor a central data registry. It's usually limited to hospitals or clinic censuses, not to the country or to the region. We do know, though, from a paper by Haran, that it is one of the top three referrals to developmental pediatrics at PGH in a paper of 2009. So in trying to look for some data here, I went to the NSO website and looked up the quick stat for September. The last one listed was September of 2019. Disability is defined as having only one hand, no hands, one leg, no legs, mild or severe cerebral palsy, retarded, mentally ill, mental retardation, and impairment. And it lists 406 individuals for that month. Now, mind you, these quick stats are not the whole country. They take a couple of areas and they just do a survey on these areas. But for this quick stat of September 2019, they have now listed the total population of the entire country at 100,981,437 counted individuals. Using a 2015 number, because that's all that's available right now, is that the percent with disability is about 1.57, or 15.7 out of 1,000. And the percent of our population at the moment below 14 years old is 31.8%. So I thought that if we did just a bit of math, we might come up with an idea of how many for the month of September have a disability. Total population times percent with disability times percent below 14 comes out to about 500,000 children with a disability. It's just a guess. We don't know, but we know we have the problem. So in 2017, Angelita Hebrero et al. Published a paper, The Profile of Pediatric Patients with Cerebral Palsy at the Department of Rehab Medicine, PGH, which does give us an insight into a bit of the problem. In this paper, they got records were obtained from patients diagnosed with CP from birth who consulted at the Rehab Medicine Outpatient Department over about a year, two-year period. And they collected a whole bunch of data on all these patients. So none of them are repeated. And they had a database of about 125 patients, which they said translated to about 8 new patients a month. Some interesting statistics that came out of this was that, number one, majority of the primary caregivers were mothers, okay? And most were under 20 years old. When they collected data on the prenatal history of previous pregnancies, 38% was unknown, 35% had had a history of previous live births, 2% neither, and there were no multiple gestations or stillbirths. About half were born by vaginal delivery. Now, this was the distribution of CP patients as to the perinatal history. Now, I wanted to point out here that if you look at the gestational age, you've got about 25.6 or almost a third that were born full term. You've got another 36% that were born premature, almost another third. And then you've got another third here that was unknown. So almost divided into thirds. Now let's look at birth weight. Again, about a third were born normal birth weight. Another third were premature and unknown about 27. Remember earlier I mentioned that the most common risk factors before were babies who were born premature and low birth weight. And we need to keep in mind that a good third, in this it seems to be divided almost equally. And then they looked at the onset and cause, and I think this is really quite interesting here. In terms of the risk factor or cause, they're using the word cause, but risk factor or cause, the perinatal was listed as 41%, and the postnatal is 34.4, meaning these were insults to the brain after the neonatal period. Could be have been anywhere from 1 month of age until the age of 5. It's quite high. It's one third. They also presented the distribution of CP patients with accompanying conditions or comorbidities. A good half had seizures. Another half had visual problems. Another half had hearing deficits. And understanding language and communication, I just have to surmise that these had pretty much cognitive deficits, and it's almost 100%. And a big portion as well with swallowing problems. This might be explained a bit by the, well, we'll go on in a minute. So they also looked at the distribution of CP with medications and surgical interventions. And just want to point out that a good number were spastic and received some sort of intervention or medication for it, medication plus injections. And at least half since got seizure medication. This is a slide that shows the ages and the limbs affected and some of the interventions. And we'll just note here that 75% were below the age of 9, with half of them at least below the age of 4. Most were spastic, at least 50%, and 36% were quadriplegic, a big number. And remember, they have the highest comorbidities and worst outcome for function. And looking at interventions, it appeared that about 64% received physical therapy, 29% in occupational therapy, and only a small portion received special ed. And yet they had all sorts of problems with communication and language. There is also some data from the Child Neurology Society of the Philippines, the Cerebral Palsy Data Registry. And this is over a period of 3 years where they registered patients in their, they had a registry in their, where they registered patients with different neurologic conditions. And out of the 5,848 patients in their database, 317 had a diagnosis of CP. And I just wanted to point out that again, a good portion, half, okay, were labeled as spastic quadriplegia. Quite a big portion. So what do we do with these kids? What happens to them? We said that the approach to treatment needs to be multimodal and multidisciplinary. It involves a team of doctors. Does this happen? Sometimes it does, sometimes it doesn't. I'd like to spend the last part of my talk about treatment options with focusing more on the medical options. But there's no question that the rehab therapy in children with cerebral palsy probably plays the biggest part of their lives. And in general, is available to a number of children here, just to different degrees and to different expertise. Most of us who have a child that we diagnose with cerebral palsy, we will refer them immediately, as soon as possible, to some sort of rehab center to try and start receiving therapy as early as possible. And this can include physiotherapy, it can include occupational therapy, speech and language therapy. And it's important because really the physical and occupational therapy is a major modality to strengthen and lengthen the weak muscles, which are of major importance in this. It helps in balance and gait training, and it helps optimize the eventual development of that child. It's also important to note what it cannot do. It does not prevent the development of CP in an infant at high risk. It does not correct the spasticity, which is permanent and unrelenting. And it doesn't correct contractures, but it can delay its onset. I would say right now in the Philippines that the BOBATH method is probably the most common one being used. This is a neurodevelopmental treatment to normalize tone, inhibit abnormal primitive reflex patterns, and facilitate automatic reactions and subsequent normal development. Your medical and surgical treatment options are mainly focused on treating spasticity and its complications. But the reason to treat a child, the degree of treatment that you're going to do, and the type of treatment that is chosen should always be taken on a case-to-case basis with regards to the impact on the functional role it will play. And risks and benefits of any modality should always be considered and explained to the patient as well. So your interventions are normally divided into your pharmacologic and your non-pharmacologic. Under your pharmacologic, you have your baclofen and your dantrolene, your muscle relaxants. You have your benzodiazepines, your Valium and your clonazepam. And then you have your alpha 2 adrenergic agonist, your tizanidine and clonidine. And then you've got your neurolytic injectable drugs, your botulinum intramuscular injections, and your fentanyl injections. So just a quick slide on some of the oral medications that are used. Baclofen is probably the most common one used here in the Philippines. The mode of action is not exactly known, but it's believed to work at the neuromuscular junction by decreasing the release of excitatory neurotransmitters from the afferent terminals. It's relatively cheap for some, and it has minimal side effects, although I find that the constipation can be a big one. And it's also important to note that baclofen can lower the seizure threshold, so you never can just withdraw it completely. Dantrolene is also used to treat spasticity, in particular very severe spasticity, but I don't find it used here much in the Philippines. And it's actually not FDA approved under the age of 5 years old. And it does carry a bit of a risk with hepatotoxicity, so you need to actually monitor the child's liver functions. Benzodiazepines have been used to help the spasticity, and indeed it may help a little, but we don't use this very much because, as we all know, you can develop tolerance and dependence, and it can cause CNS depression, and that is not ideal in a young child. So then we get to your neurolytic medications. This is basically your botulinum and your fentanyl. So your botulinum is usually given as a botulinum type A, a Botox thing, the same thing that's used that all the dermatologists are using. And it's used mostly in smaller muscles and for focal spasticity, in particular in the lower legs. It works best if given between 1 to 6 years old. It's usually injected right into the muscle, and the child can resume normal activity right away. However, the effect doesn't take place for about 3 to 7 days. And it is short acting. It only lasts 3 to 6 months, oftentimes just three. So reinjection and repetition is necessary. There is also a precaution with it that it can form antibodies, and an overdose can cause a respiratory arrest. Now, fentanyl is actually the older drug used way before the Botox came into play. But now it's used mostly in adults or in conjunction in a severe spastic quadriplegic patient. It's used often in the larger muscles. It's the problem with it, it's injected onto the nerve. So one, you need to have a little more expertise and technique in doing this. You need a nerve stimulator. And it also is painful. So often the child or the person needs to be sedated. After that's placed, you need to rest for 1 to 2 weeks. However, it does take place, the effect takes effect immediately, and it lasts longer, about 4 to 12 months. It can cause some minor skin irritation at the time, some irritation, some temporary sensory dyskinesias, but it has an advantage of being a lower cost, better stability, and no antibody formation. But even when you use these drugs, it still comes in combination with physical therapy. It's really a multimodal treatment. You've got your symptoms of spasticity. You try first your oral medications and your injectable drugs, but you still must continue with your physical therapy that works on the weakness that does develop. And if the spasticity progresses and becomes worse and we get contractures, then you've got to call in your your arthrosurgeons. So your treatment options, as I said, really focuses on your rehab. There are some medical options to treat the spasticity, surgical options to treat the contractures, and others have tried other modes of therapy. Acupuncture has been tried. There is neurodevelopmental training, sensory integration, electrical stimulation, and stem cell therapy, which I understand will be the next discussion, and I look forward to hearing about that. So, what do we do? Early diagnosis is the key. As I said, early diagnosis and early intervention is the key role to maximizing the plasticity of the young brain and with an eventual better outcome. There are things as doctors and as societies that we can do here in the Philippines to improve on this. First would be prevention. to try and prevent it from happening. We know that premature birth and low birth weight are risk factors. We need to install more measures to prevent this. Health measures to improve neonatal care and avoid CNS infections. And it wouldn't be a bad idea to really elevate a public campaign to alleviate traumatic brain injury, which is one of the major causes for your postnatal, or one of the major risk factors in your postnatal category. It's also important that we pay attention to the risk factors. When we see a child in a regular infant or child checkup, we need to ask about risk factors, because if we can have the risk factor, it can lead us down the road to watching this child carefully and performing a more detailed examination and seeing if the cerebral palsy is developing. Close attention to developmental milestones and persistence of primitive reflexes can really, really focus you and direct you in the right direction. And once a diagnosis is made, then early referral for treatment. Again, a multidisciplinary approach is best if possible, perhaps with more regional treatment centers and streamlining the referral system, it would be helpful. And the last I've got to mention is cost. All of this costs. It costs to the family, it costs to society. One of the best things that's ever been done is the program of the person with a disability. Need to register that child as a person with a disability. I can't tell you the number of times I've seen a child that has come in at a much older age, been through so much, so many hospitalizations, therapies, doctors, tests, and he still doesn't have his registration as a PWD. I emphasize to do this, to ask if they're registered, and if not, start the papers going. I thank you very much for listening. This is the end of my talk, and many thanks to the doctors listed below who were able to help me and give me information to help put together this talk. Thank you very much.
And now for our second speaker, let us welcome Dr. Nguyen Thanh Liem.
Ladies and gentlemen, thank you very much for inviting me to your meeting. My topic today is indications and outcomes of stem cell therapy for incurable disease in children. Nowadays, stem cell nonfiction is more interesting than the fiction. And I will tell you different story about stem cell application. What are stem cells? Stem cells are cells with two important characters. They can self-renew, but still maintain their original characters. And they can differentiate into different cells. How we can classify stem cell? There are some different ways to classify stem cell. In general, we can classify them into three groups, including totipotent stem cell derived from morula, pluripotent embryonic stem cell derived from blastocyst, and multipotent stem cell derived from different tissue, from cord blood, from umbilical cord tissue, from adipose, from bone marrow. From where we can get stem cell? We can get stem cell from many places, from embryo, from umbilical cord blood or umbilical cord tissue, from bone marrow, from adipose, and many other places. One special kind of stem cell, so-called iPSC, discovered by Yamataka and Thompson. From fibroblast, they induce some genes and change fibroblast to iPSC. Their work got Nobel Prize in 2012. What kind of stem cell most commonly used in clinical setting? They are hematopoietic stem cell, mesenchymal stem cell, and iPSC. Nowadays, stem cell not only in the lab, but move to clinical application. I will tell you our application of stem cell for different diseases. The most common application in our institute is cerebral palsy. You know, cerebral palsy is a burden for family and also for society. Lifetime cost in the US around $1 million per person. CP reduced quality of life of patient and of the whole family. In CP, due to asphyxia during delivery, brain was atrophy and was damaged around ventricle. You can see a video of a child with the CP. He can only lie down, could not sit up. Our reason use bone marrow mononuclear cell transplantation for CP due to oxygen deprivation. We collect bone marrow from the bilateral anterior iliac crest under general anesthesia with a volume of 8 ml per kilogram. Then we send to the lab for processing. When we obtain mononuclear cell, we infuse to medullary cavity between the fourth and the fifth lumbar vertebra. We combine with 10-week rehabilitation program. We can see our number about the different cell, including HSC, mononuclear cell, and mesenchymal stem cell. We didn't have any severe adverse event. Minor adverse event was spontaneously resolved or with the medication. After transplantation, important improvement of gross motor function occurs in own patient. For example, lying and rolling at baseline was 31 point, increased to 64.81 after 6 months. Sitting also increased, rolling, kneeling, standing also increased significantly. You can see the total GMFM increased significantly, lying and rolling also increased, sitting increased, rolling and kneeling, standing increased importantly. In CP patient, the muscle increase, causing pain and limited movement. We use artwork score to measure the muscle, and you can see after transplantation, the muscle decrease significantly. We also measure quality of life before and 6 months after stem cell transplantation. We see quality of life change significantly 6 months after the stem cell therapy. We also noted the improvement of Denver score after 6 months of transplantation. You can see one of our patients. Before transplantation, he can walk but difficult to maintain balance, easy to fall down. But after transplantation, he can walk he can maintain his balance. Our publication using bone marrow mononuclear cell transplantation or CP due to aphasia. We also use stem cell for cerebral palsy related to neonatal connectors. We know that neonatal connectors cause severe CP. It is characters a patient at baseline. Most of them suffer from severe form of CP. Six months after transplantation and 12 months after transplantation, the improvement was observed in different domains of motor function. You can see, for example, lying and rolling increased from 34 to 48 and then to 51. Other domains also increased significantly. You can see the change of motor function in different domains. And similar to CP due to aphasia, the muscle spasticity also decreased significantly after transplantation. Our publication. We perform stem cell transplantation for cerebral palsy related to intracranial hemorrhage. Our outcome with the four patients are very good before transplantation and after transplantation, before transplantation and after transplantation, you can stand up and walk. Our publication. What about neurologic sequelae due to drowning? Drowning, unfortunately, is still common in Vietnam. I don't know about Philippines. This is a child. After drowning, he suffers from the vegetative state. We use stem cell for four children, and you can see different domain of motor function increase significantly. Before and after. Our manuscripts were accepted and will be published soon in Frontier in Pediatric. Encephalitis and meningitis are common diseases in children, and many of them suffer from neurologic sequelae. We use stem cell with the good outcome. You can see our video. After suffering from an infection of central nervous system. Thank you. now. We also perform a stem cell therapy for children with vegetative state after autoimmune encephalitis. So far, we have performed a stem cell therapy for two children with a very good outcome. You can see one of them through this video. She lost awareness, epilepsy, and only lay down. But after second transplantation, she could sit up, she could eat. And after three transplantation, the second common application of stem cell in our institute is for autism. Autism spectrum disorder is very common disease now. With the two important characters, persistent deficit in communication and social interaction, restricted repetitive behavior and interest. You can see a child with the typical autism, repetitive behavior. We don't know exactly about the pathophysiology of autism, however, We can understand some aspects of autism, for example, brain hyperperfusion, overactive immune reaction, produce harmful cytokine to neuron, and genetic abnormality, environment factor, and maybe epigenetic factor. We perform stem cell transplantation for autism similar to perform stem cell transplantation for CP. We combine with 12 weeks of intensive education program according to early start Denver model for young children. Our research with the 30 patients and stone to measure the improvement of the patient after transplantation. You can see after transplantation, many improvement in different domain. For example, for social interaction. At baseline, only 37% could have a social interaction, but it increased to 60% and then 77% at 12 months and 97% at 12 months. Eye contact also increased from 23% at baseline to 93% after 18 months. Language capacity increased from 47% to 83% after 18 months. Daily skill also increased significantly. About abnormal behavior before and after transplantation. Most children have hyperactivity, 93% at baseline, but it reduced to 43% 18 months after transplantation. We also observe improvement in CAS score and violence score with the different domain, including communication, daily living skill, socialization, and motor skill. Our manuscript was accepted and will be published soon as Stem Cell Translational Medicine Journal. Stem cell therapy also very effective for bronchopulmonary dysplasia. So far, we have performed stem cell therapy for 10 cases, 3 cases with autologous bone marrow monoglial cell, and 7 cases with umbilical cord mesenchymal stem cell. You can see before stem cell transplantation, the lung fibrosis was very severe. But after transplantation, fibrosis disappeared completely. You can see a video of a child before transplantation, difficult to breathe. But after 6 months, almost normal. Our publication. We perform stem cell therapy for some surgical condition, for example, for biliary atresia. Serious guys with their biliary atresia, we perform Kasai procedure at 3 months. He developed quite well, but at 3 years old, he came back to me due to liver cirrhosis. I performed stem cell transplantation. And 1 year later, he came back to me due to intestinal obstruction. I performed reoperation, and during operation, I was very surprised when I saw his liver. It was rose and sharp like normal liver, and now it still develops quite well. We perform stem cell therapy for 19 patients with the biliary atresia. The procedure was safe and early outcome are good. We are still follow up for long-term result. Stem cell therapy is also very effective for bowel and urinary dysfunction after spina bifida surgery. We perform stem cell therapy for 18 patients. 6 patients have fecal continence after therapy. 13 patients improve in urodynamic, and 8 patients improve in motor function of lower limbs. our publication. Lastly, I performed stem cell therapy for neuron intestinal disorder this last year. Two patients, and both of them develop quite well. They can pass stool normally now. So in conclusion, ladies and gentlemen, they can say stem cell technology is a revolution in medicine. I would like to thank all my team member who contribute very important role in our success. And thank you very much for your listening.
Let us welcome again our two speakers for the question and answer portion, moderated by Dr. Aison.
Good morning. Good morning, Dr. Butler. Xin Xiao, Dr. Professor Liem. Our the two speakers for this morning.
Good morning.
Good morning. Could you hear me?
Yes, very loud and clear. I know it's a little bit far, that's Hanoi, but you're loud and clear and you're looking good.
Good.
Nevertheless, we'll start the ball rolling with regards to questions. I divided the question and answer, meaning the open forum, into the first part, an interactive between the two speakers. I know Dr. Butler has lots of questions for Professor Liem. And please. I will perhaps start with our open forum with a panel discussion between the two speakers.
Good morning, sir. It was a pleasure to listen to your talk. I am actually a fan of stem cell therapy. I just don't know if we're quite there yet. So I was very interested in hearing what you have been doing with kids with neurologic problems. I would like to know, so when you harvest, you said you're using bone marrow, is that correct?
Yes, in most cases we use bone marrow. Some cases we use mesenchymal stem cell from umbilical cord tissue.
Yeah, that's. I was wondering if you were using that more, or whether you were using more the bone marrow.
Bone marrow more.
Okay. So my question is, is this a one-step procedure? I've actually been involved in some stem cell in another country once, actually a while back. Where they actually took the bone marrow in one go, they sedated the child, took the bone marrow, processed it, and then gave it right back because it's painful for the removal of the bone marrow, so the child was under sedation. Now, how do you do it when you actually do it with these small kids? You sedate them, you remove the bone marrow, and then at the same time, an hour later, give it back, or they come back? How does this work?
We collect stem cell, then we send to the lab for processing around 3 to 4 hours, and then we give back to the patient.
So are they sedated for the removal? Where do you get the bone marrow from? The thigh? From the which bone? Which part?
Anterior iliac crest.
Got it. So are they sedated for that procedure?
Yes. Curious. Under general anesthesia.
Yeah, so then the bone marrow is sent off, it's processed, and then the same day or a few hours later, you'll give it back, or the next day, or how does it?
After 3 hours something, 3 to 4 hours on the same day.
Right, but they're not sedated all that time, correct? I'm just looking at a whole technical process here. Okay, and what determines whether you're going to do it more than once or just one time? I noticed some of your patients, you said after the second or third, and then some, I think you just did one.
Yeah.
In cerebral palsy, did you ever do it more than one time? Were those children ever given more than one treatment?
It depends on the disease. For autism, we recommend 2 times with interval of 6 months. For transplantation modification. After two times, if it's good, it's okay. Otherwise, we would like to add one more. But maximum four times, because we think if we collect the bone marrow more than four times, we can cause bone marrow failure.
And after it's done, you still combine it with physiotherapy or physical therapy and occupational therapy, correct?
Yeah, certainly. We have combined. We have we perform the rehab at our hospital for some week, then we teach the parent and they have to continue.
Have you considered in trying a randomized controlled trial where you would give the stem cell to some and not to others, you know, and then comparing the two groups?
I wish to do, but it is a problem.
Because ultimately that would probably be, you know, the best trial.
Yeah.
Then of course we're all wondering here is you know, how much does it cost? Because I know that this is actually quite a costly procedure in other countries. And here as well, when it's done for certain reasons.
One time costs around $4,000 one time. Yes.
So it might be a little costly for our population, but for some it may be able to be done.
Yeah.
Okay. Have you found any benefit in doing it earlier? And when you looked at your patients with cerebral palsy, you know, we talk about early intervention always, and we're pushing for early intervention. Have you seen in the cerebral palsy children, is there any, have you, you know, looked at your patient population that you've done? Was there any possibility of matching, and then which was done earlier or later? Do you have any recommendations?
Yeah, I agree with you. As other treatment, earlier, better. So now I would like to perform a stem cell around 1 year.
Okay. Is there a weight limit? Because you know how often many of these children are very underweight. So I just wondered, is there a weight? Do they have to be a certain weight before you can do it?
Weight is not a big problem, but around 8 kilograms, it would be okay. Because we have some risk with the anesthesia. So smaller is, of course, is better for children, but more risk.
Yeah, I think technically it's also more difficult.
Yeah.
I think that you should try see if you can, you know, look at between the patients that got it and the patients that didn't get it with therapy in both groups. It would be interesting to know that. I have read some reports that stated most of them did state that it helped with gross motor function. But many hadn't gone on for a long time. They were only looking at it 6 months later. It appears some of your kids you've looked at longer, which is good information. I hope that you're going to continue to follow those kids as well.
Yeah,
that would be important data later on, you know?
Yeah, thank you.
We'd be interested in hearing that data.
Yes.
Okay. Thank you very much.
Professor.
Nice to see you.
Right. I have some questions, Liem.
Yes, please.
Particularly in your group with asphyxia, I know that's the most common in your study, okay?
Yeah.
And I was not aware, or your lecture was not, I did not get it. How many patients did you have stem cell therapy for asphyxia, cerebral palsy?
In our study, we have different studies, so
right.
Totally around 100 patients.
100, so that's the most common patients that you handled, asphyxia, cerebral palsy. But nevertheless, reading on stem cell therapy with cerebral palsy patients, yes, it's very common, patients to introduce stem cell therapy. And in the study of Alfred Kaplan, considered as the mesenchymal stem cell father, I know you had some patients undergoing stem cell with bone marrow as well as mesenchymal, right? You introduced both.
Yes.
But why concentrate on the mesenchymal than over the rather your bone marrow over your mesenchymal?
There are two reasons. Bone marrow mononuclear cells are cheaper.
Yeah.
For mesenchymal stem cell, you have to collect, you have to culture, you have to expand, so more expensive. But of course, the application is wider because we can inject even for patients from 6 months.
Good. So, as mentioned by Dr. Butler earlier, it's very expensive, right?
Yeah.
And from the looks of it, it seems that most of your patients are funded, right?
Yeah.
So you get most of the expenses for stem cell transplantation from sponsors, I guess. Mm-hmm.
For cost, because my hospital is a private hospital, but if you can do in public hospital, maybe the price will be reduced.
Yeah, I know that being the director of Vinmec, which is the biggest hospital in Vietnam, which started the stem cell biomolecular laboratory, it's more expensive. We have not introduced it to the government hospitals yet. Yeah. Not yet. Any other questions?
May I ask another question? Yes, so is stem cell therapy for these disorders, is this considered compassionate use in Vietnam, or is this allowed? Are there government regulations with stem cell therapy?
Yeah, we have. And every new treatment, we have to register, to submit, and to ethic committee, and then we should have approval from ethic committee of Ministry of Health.
Okay. I remembered another question or a comment I was going to make. I was very interested when you presented your patients with the one patient in particular there that looked like it was a mixture of an extrapyramidal and pyramidal CP. Mm. These kids are the hardest ones with both the spasticity and the movement disorders. You had that one child that looked like he did well. I only saw the one. I mean, you had a picture of one. Do you have quite a few of those? Have they done any better, or does it work better on the spastic CP? Because the extrapyramidal, they're really the hardest kids to treat. We have no perfect drug.
Yeah, you are right. As I mentioned, spasticity reduced after transplantation, and it occurred rather early, mm-hmm. even before other changes.
Right.
Muscle spasticity reduced very early after transplantation, and that is one important factor to increase the movement.
In your patients with the kernicterus, how early were they given the stem cell therapy?
Now, some patients around 1 or 2 years, but most patients in my publication, they came late.
I wonder if there would be a benefit if it was given earlier in those kids.
Certainly. Yeah.
Thank you.
Something related, Liem, to our passion, which is pediatric surgery. You're starting already with the stem cell application for surgical patients, right?
Yeah.
And you mentioned something about after Kasai, the usefulness of stem cell in case they would go on liver cirrhosis, right?
Yeah.
And it could help in the regeneration of your liver cells, for that matter. Were the two post-Kasai patients you had, if I remember right, three or four, which had liver cirrhosis. What kind of cirrhosis was it? Was it a fulminant, irreversible cirrhosis?
I think that is irreversible cirrhosis due to liver, due to biliary atresia in most cases.
But nevertheless, the usefulness was brought about after the Kasai procedure. Right? The usefulness of stem cell. So Kasai first and then stem cell for the cirrhosis.
Yeah. There are both ways we have to consider. We can perform stem cell after Kasai, but I think we should infuse stem cell very early after Kasai. Now I would like to do it 3 months after Kasai. The other way, you can do the same time, Kasai operation and then and the same time with the stem cell infusion.
Thank you, Liem. On another note, in your last part of your lecture, you started using it with neuronal intestinal dysplasia, particularly those with spina bifida patients. And I see that you had two NID. Any words or any experience with Hirschsprung's for that matter?
I have not tried.
But the NID patients that you had, two
patients,
were diagnosed NID, neuronal intestinal dysplasia.
Yeah, right. Yeah. After other operation without successful.
Good. Yeah, do you have any questions for Dr. Butler in Manila? Right.
What about the autoimmune encephalitis in Philippines?
Autoimmune
encephalitis.
Yes. Well, we have autoimmune encephalitis here, no question about it. And those, and a lot of that population, you know, a good number don't recover fully. Some do, but a lot are left with certainly deficits of seizures and some abnormal movements. But we haven't, you know, I don't think stem cell has not come up as a treatment for that. I was interested in your presentation there. We certainly have autoimmune encephalitis. Definitely.
Right.
Quite a good number. Mm-hmm. We're making the diagnosis more now, I think, more because we have the tools to do it. You know, 20 years ago, the tools weren't there. Now we have all the tools. And we're more aware.
So you can measure the antibody now?
Yes, we can.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's available here now. Yes.
Yeah. Thank you.
You're talking about the anti-NMDA, correct? Is that
right?
What, yeah. Yes, right. Yes, we can. No, it can be measured here now. Yes,
oh, good.
It's available. It's costly, but it is available, which helps a lot.
Yeah, thank you.
Before opening the floor to our questions from the web viewers, I'd like to thank the both of you for giving us your insights and inputs on stem cell. Pia, do we have some questions from our web viewers?
Yes, sir. We have a number of questions both from YouTube and from Zoom. So the first question is regarding the cost. How much is stem cell therapy for foreigners? And are there packages for foreigners who want their children to undergo stem cell therapy, especially for autism spectrum disorder, and if they are covered by medical insurance?
I believe that's for Dr. Liem. The question was, how much is it to have, as mentioned by you, it's about $4,000, right?
Yeah, for one time.
The first one cycle.
Yeah, one cycle.
Would there be any offers of what you call a service rate or a charity rate or a package for that matter?
For our patient, for our study, patient have not to pay.
Two cycles, right?
Yeah.
But would there be any offer of a package which would turn out to be more or less cheaper?
No, we don't have a program for this.
Right, but nevertheless, Liem, your offer, you offer it to foreigners for that matter, non-Vietnamese.
We can, yes.
So any Filipino would be interested with a patient with cerebral palsy would be able to go to Vietnam and have your stem cell therapy.
Yeah, they can come, yeah.
Just, of course, get in touch with you. Any other questions, Pia?
For Dr. Liem, Do you have controls where the patients were only received rehab and not stem cell therapy during your research?
Thank you. I am sorry that we have not performed a randomized study to compare the patient received stem cell and those who did not receive. That would be very good study to do in future.
Also, there is a similar question. Were there studies comparing the effect of stem cell therapy in younger patients versus in older patients?
Was there, there a study, or were you able to differentiate the effects of stem cell transplantation on between younger patients and older patients? Would it be better for older or younger?
The younger, the better. Yeah. So we should perform it early, as early as possible.
There's another question regarding the spectrum of patients who underwent stem cell therapy. Is there a study done on autoimmune problems like pemphigus bullous?
Yes, but so far, the pediatrician start with the medical treatment first. If they don't have results, so we will perform stem cell.
So you had some experience with autoimmune as well?
Yeah. For autoimmune encephalitis and autoimmune hepatitis, and of course for MS, I don't know, multiple sclerosis, we also perform hematopoietic stem cell with a good result.
For this question is directed to Dr. Liem. This was asked by Fatima Johanna Santos on Zoom. What factors do you correlate in terms of improvements in treated patients? Are there any baseline markers biochemically, like cytokine levels, that you look at during your research? And are there contraindications to stem cell therapy?
Thank you. It depends. For example, for autism, in our research on autism, we use PET CT to monitor brain metabolism before and after transplantation. For CP and other disease, we are doing a research to monitor the growth factor cytokine in the cerebral fluid before and after stem cell transplantation. We would like to know if stem cell can secrete the so-called cytokine or growth factor, so they can enhance the quality of neuron. So it depends on the it's research.
So you do have some chemical studies backing this outcome, not just the motor as well.
Yeah.
Or improvement.
Yeah.
Yeah.
This question is again for Dr. Liem.
Yes.
Among your patients, are there noted improvements in their behavior, especially those in patients with autism? And for how long were these improvements noted?
You mean how long we can see the changes?
Yes, during follow-up. Yes, sir, during follow-up.
During follow-up. In general, early changes around 3 months after transplantation, but more evident after 6 months.
And is it not correct, sir, you're continuing to follow these children, right? Hopefully. See if the effect is longer, I would think, in all of them.
We continue to follow the patients.
Yeah.
Yes, and there's another question regarding freezing stem cell therapy. Have you done homologous stem cell therapy rather than autologous stem cell therapy? And can stem cells be harvested from donors and frozen until use in other patients?
Thank you. we use autologous stem cell in most cases, but now we are developing stem cell from other donor. Especially we develop stem cell from umbilical cord tissue because they are very available to collect and we don't have a ethic problem. And we would like to produce in that trillion, to have a stem cell. They are ready to use anytime.
There is one question, sir, regarding the administration of stem cell therapy. What route of administration did you experiment on? Intravenous or the same in the bone marrow? Were there attempts to do it spinal or oral?
Yes. In general, we would like to use simple way, but as close as to the target organ. So for example, for CP or for autism, we use intrathecal route. For bronchopulmonary, we use intravenous way. For liver, we use intrahepatic artery. So it depends on the different disease, so we use different way.
This next question is for Dr. Butler. Do you see the probability of using stem cell therapy in cerebral palsy patients in the Philippines in the near future?
Well, I think that I foresee it being used, but the near future part may not be the case. Stem cell therapy is regulated here in the Philippines. And it's not one of the indications as yet approved by the Philippine government and the Department of Health and all that. So it would, if it's going to be used, it probably would have to be used on a compassionate basis. So we're not quite there yet, but there are people who are you know, working at this. So I think that one day, I myself happen to be a big believer in stem cell. I think that it's going to change a lot of disorders. And it's already being used, you know, in certain diseases, in your hematopoietic diseases, and some skin diseases as well, and eye. But for this particular disorder, I think we might have to wait a little bit of time, or we might have to send our patients to Vietnam and have it done somewhere else. We'll see. But I do think one day, but maybe not in the near future.
So there are more questions for Dr. Butler. In your experience here in the Philippines, do cerebral palsy patients ever achieve functionality using our conventional methods here in the country? And what would you recommend to lessen the cerebral palsy burden here in the Philippines?
Well, kids, you know, children with cerebral palsy, the how much function they develop will depend on how early they get intervention and their underlying disorder, how severe the disease was. So, yes, some of these kids do quite well when they get the therapy and have parents and family and support that do it. And even kids who don't have a whole lot of finances, depending on how severe, they can go on and do a whole lot of stuff. In terms of what can we do to prevent, I think the government has already, we've already started trying to prevent prematurity and low birth weight by introducing the EINC in your birthing plans. And there are measures being taken. But of course, we've got to work a little bit harder. And I think really is trying to improve our health clinics, not just in urban areas, but in the provincial settings, so that you have people watching out for these kids that may have problems and not having to, you know, that they get diagnosed so late and then there's no physical therapy that they can obtain or no advice on what to do. And if we're going to look at anything that's come out of this whole COVID thing, like what we're doing right now with telemedicine, physical therapists have learned how to continue their sessions online. And this now could be translated into extending to the whole country. So even if a patient is diagnosed in the province or in some remote area, the possibility lies that it will still receive therapy. And it's, therapy really is the mainstay of the treatment right now. So I think there are measures that are already being done, but we certainly room for improvement.
Thank you, Dr. Butler. I think the next question is directed to both Dr. Butler and Dr. Liem. How about the use of embryonic stem cells?
For embryonic stem cell, there are some limitations. The first one is ethic problem, because you know embryo is a live body. And the second is stem cell from embryos can differentiate very strongly to different cell and organ. And the potential risk of cancer is still a big concern. So at least so far, we don't focus on embryonic stem cell.
I think also that if you're using the embryonic stem cell, right, I mean, you're going to have to process it, store it for a while. It's I can see why you're using the bone marrow, because it's an immediate process and it's right from that same person, you know, whereas the embryonic is going to have to be stored for a while, or you're taking it from a different person, and it is technically, and it, you have more problems in how it's going to be used. But I know that other countries, that there is stem cell, they're using the embryonic type as well for CP.
Yes, but as I mentioned, not many teams use embryonic stem cell.
Yeah.
Because there are some problem with the ethic aspect.
This question is from Dr. Leo Olarte, delivered via Zoom. For Dr. Butler, do you have any experience in the treatment of club foot in using your regimen?
Well, club foot, when diagnosed, often is work. If that's part of your multidisciplinary approach, that is to get the surgeons involved. Therapy alone is not going to cure a club foot, depending on the degree. Sometimes you can do certain maneuvers and certain you can cast them, but you may need surgery eventually. You may not. It'll depend on the degree, but therapy alone doesn't often correct that. If it's a real club foot.
Dr. Leo Olarte has raised his hand. You may speak now, sir.
Yes, hello. Okay, thank you very much, Dr. Liem, for your very informative lecture on stem cells. I am interested in the use of oral stem cells from animals. Do you have any experience or any information about the use of oral stem cells from animals or xenogenic stem cells? Thank you very much, Dr. Liem.
Yeah. Thank you, because the stem cell we can get easy from humans, so we don't think we need to use a xeno stem cell.
How about the oral use of stem cells? Is it? Do you have any experience aside from injectable stem cells by mouth?
By mouth.
Drinking the stem cells.
By mouth. I never try and I never heard. But through nose. Yes, somebody used stem cell through nose, and they said they can work. I never try.
Last question for Dr. Butler. In CP or cerebral palsy, most of our orthopedic patients, being an orthopedic surgeon at the National Children's Hospital, have the spastic form of diplegia in CP. Do you have any experience with your regimen without the use of releasing procedures in spastic cerebral palsy of the joints?
Well, I work more in the diagnosing part and the referral part, but I will tell you that, you know, of course it depends on how early you get the child and how early you're trying to prevent this from even happening. You know, so you're trying to get them started with their therapy early, or whatever intervention you're going to do, medications, therapy, to prevent the contractures and your problems that eventually occur in your spastic diplegia. And then later, you know, the casting may be involved. The whole idea is to get that child ambulatory. And in where you have early support and early intervention, a lot of those kids will walk. We often say if they don't walk by 10, they're not going to walk. But it will depend on the therapy and what medications can be given and how much you can reduce the spasticity. So certainly there's going to be kids who are just very severe, and then you start to wonder, well, I wonder if stem cell or what alternative therapy. And patients seek this out. They know that we don't have a perfect, you know, way of treating this. And that's why I think people are looking for other ways to figure it out. But we, you know, early intervention, early therapy helps a lot. Physical therapy.
Thank you, Dr. Butler, and thank you, Professor Liem, for your very informative stem cell information. I would like to see you in Vietnam,
Dr. Please. Liem. Please, we are happy to have you here.
Yes.
Thank you, Dr. for your questions. Thank you. Pia, do we still have other questions from the floor?
We have a follow-up question from Ms. Fatima Johanna Santos Ocampo in Zoom. This is for Dr. Liem. What clinical advantage do you see with homologous versus autologous stem cell transplants, considering the need for pre-stem cell ablation, waiting for a good match, chances of rejection, etc.?
Thank you. For autologous stem cell, of course, no rejection. For allogeneic stem cell, mesenchymal stem cell has privilege. It means that their immunity character very low, so no rejection, almost no rejection. So we can use mesenchymal stem cell from one person for different person without rejection. And we never use immunosuppression medication after transplantation.
Yes, sir. For the last question, there are participants asking if we may know the clinic address of Dr. Liem in Vietnam so that they can refer or bring patients in.
Yes. Actually, the technology for autologous stem cell from bone marrow is not very difficult. So it's not difficult to apply in Philippines if you like.
For the address of those, Dr. Liem, those interested, I am the manager of Dr. Liem. You could perhaps get in touch with me. No, seriously, Liem.
Yes.
You know, you see, stem cell is very much controlled in our country, the Philippines. In fact, the earlier person who gave a question on stem cell, Dr. Lay Olarte, they started the Stem Cell Society already. Our country, and I guess Dr. Olarte knows that, there were four or five of them who started the Stem Cell Society, but they were not allowed to proceed further on. And nevertheless, this is one question perhaps that I would and everybody would want to have to ask you, Liem. How about for rejuvenation? Have you had any experience, and would you accept perhaps me as a patient for the purpose of rejuvenation using stem cell?
Yes, you are very welcome.
Thank you. Yeah. Would that be free?
Yeah, you can come.
Yes, you heard that, ladies and gentlemen. So the next webinar, perhaps next year, we will have a testimonial from me regarding rejuvenation effects by stem cell.
Yeah.
I'd like to give a testimonial to my good friend, Liem. Thank you very much. You know, Professor Liem is not a new, he's a frequenter in our country. In fact, we had a lot of moments with him. He has been with us ever since several years back, I think it was 2015, 2014. And we've been in touch with Dr. Liem for so long with regards to laparoscopic surgery. His first love is really laparoscopic surgery. And he has been with that since the time, and he's actually the guru for laparoscopic surgery in the entire world. People respected him in those with minimal invasive surgery, like Rothenberg, Butler of, I don't know whether he's related to you, Dr. Butler of Australia, Liem of Malaysia, respects, the IPEG respects Dr. Nguyen, Thanh, Liem, and I was lucky to have him as a good friend way back, and there came a helping hand in laparoscopic surgery in pediatrics between our two countries. He started his laparoscopic way back in late 80s, and in this particular slide, he was studying biliary. His interest was biliary, actually, pediatric biliary. In this case, he was studying in France, or rather in Paris, with regards to Kasai surgery. He has been a good mentor for me. For the past several years, I've been in and out of his country in Vietnam, learning pediatric laparoscopic surgery. And he has really tremendously helped me, as well as most Filipinos pediatric surgeons in the field of pediatric laparoscopic surgery, to the point that he has given several lectures. This is my good friend Delphine Paunco awarding him in one of his lectures in Manila. He is, in fact, for those young pediatric surgeons of PSPS, he is an honorary fellow of the Philippine Society of Pediatric Surgeons way back early 2010. So, and when I visit his house, every time I visit his house, he treasures that membership. This is the only diploma I see in his house, which is our diploma for him being an honorary fellow. And I appreciate that. That gesture, Professor Liem. He used to head this government hospital, used to be the National Hospital for Pediatrics, and he was the one who developed it to this size. It's called already National Children's Hospital of Hanoi, Vietnam. And ever since retirement in the early 2010s, he became now the Vinmec medical director, which prompted him to change his passion, his third passion in life, which is stem cell therapy. Vinmec is the largest and the biggest hospital in Vietnam. And of course, with very much funding from the owner of the hospital. So he was able to put up the molecular lab, which serves as the source for stem cell therapy in Vietnam. So this is the molecular lab way back when I visited that hospital. And just to emphasize his recognitions in Southeast Asia, in 2018, he was given the Nikkei Asia Award for Science by no less than Prime Minister Abe, Shinzo Abe of Japan in 2018. With him was Prime Minister Abe, and in this picture as well is the very beautiful Madame Sin, the wife of Professor Liem. He's a very simple man, As you can see, he wears also shorts. So, and he is a good mentor to me, a big brother and a good friend. And in fact, we share the same son. His son, who is already a pediatric surgeon, studied with us in the Philippines and got married to a Filipina just recently, a doctor Filipina. This is the wedding that I godfathered him. So we have a common son who is known as Kwang to us. Thank you, Professor Liem. And I know that this is something that we owe it to you, the services to our society. Thank you very much. And thank you as well to Dr. Butler.
Thank you also for inviting me. Thank you.
With that, I turn over the microphone or the floor to our closing ceremonies.
Well, good afternoon. It has been a very informative session, and I thank Dr. Carolyn Butler and Professor Nguyen Thanh Liem for a very excellent lecture on neurology. And of course, to our very young colleague, Dr. Aison. Our moderator. Okay, as always, we are grateful to Calmosep team for their unconditional support. Stem cell therapy in the Philippines has come of age, and though relatively new, its application holds a limited application still in the Philippines, but a promising treatment for a number of cases. As in point in this morning's session, treatment of diseases that seem to be impossible is showing some light in the tunnel, so to speak. And this lecture has shown some insights into the future that can help us in the care of special children. As Dr. Butler has mentioned, neurologic diseases like cerebral palsies, early diagnosis who are treated early have better functional outcome and therefore minimizing social and economic burden. I agree that there is no perfect world, and in fact, our country is one example of the real world. We still hope to improve diagnosis for a better treatment. And I agree, national registry is important to really have a background on Philippine statistics and have a better understanding of these diseases. And for Dr. Professor Liem's experience in his opening slides, stem cell nonfiction is more interesting than fiction. This is evidenced by improving gross motor function to include muscle tone, decreasing spasticity for his patient, and also a promising treatment for surgical diseases like biliary atresia. To Dr. Liem, his innovative work serves as an inspiration to us all. In the treatment of an ailing child, anything is possible for an enthusiastic, innovative, and caring health worker. Well, it's another webinar of productive learning for all of us, students in an unending quest for knowledge. A third webinar is still coming this August, and I would like to invite you all again. We will be posting it soon. And may this day bring you all the best. Good morning. Stay safe. Salamat.
Thank you for joining us this morning. All those who registered at our website will be receiving an email to the link for your certificate of attendance and CPD credits. You'll have to fill up the survey form in order to get your CPD credits. Thank you.